Bonnie Urbay. Welcome to the Contrary, a discussion of news and social trends from diverse perspectives. Up first, we are not leading with the non-substantive developments in the presidential race on this topic, but on substantive policy changes and trends changing the abortion debate.
Overall, abortion, both medical and surgical, is on the decline in the U.S. Since 1996, the number of abortions per year has decreased by 30% to fewer than 1 million. In 2000, the FDA approved the medical abortion pill as an alternative to surgical abortion. Today, the abortion pill accounts for nearly one quarter of all terminated pregnancies. And just this week, the FDA relaxed its guidelines, making it easier for doctors to prescribe it. Until now, regulations barred doctors in some states from recommending a lower dose of the drug, mifepristone, a practice considered standard in medicine. Doctors say the pill is just as effective at lower doses and has fewer side effects. Some practitioners said they would not prescribe the abortion pill if their only option was the higher dose. This comes at a time when states are putting more restrictions on abortion and abortion providers limiting access to women seeking to terminate pregnancies.
So, Congresswoman, is this pointing to the fact that science is advancing beyond surgical abortions and now women are free to take pills and not have to cross picket lines?
Bonnie, science is neither Republican or Democrat, but it's certainly deciding this issue on the pro-choice side.
I take the opposite view. I think science is deciding it on the pro-life side. And I'd also say I don't think that surgical abortions are going to go away because women are confronted with the remains of their baby when they take RU486.
I think it's eventually going to be passé because science is advancing and anything non-invasive is certainly more safe for women.
My personal views aside, for millennial women like me, we remember being in college and having the availability of a pill to terminate an unwanted pregnancy. So I think surgical abortions are becoming passé for that reason.
But you, as a leader, and welcome to the panel,
Thank
Penny.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Sure. Happy to. As a leader of the pro-life movement, how are you going to fight this? Because the FDA is approving it and women are using it. And it's not like you can go to court or go to the state legislature, as the pro-life movement has in so many states, and chip away at that ability to take a pill instead of getting an abortion.
Well, sadly, I think, as I indicated earlier, I think that we're going to see this trend turn in the other direction, because I'm already hearing stories of women who are traumatized by the remains of their baby when they are confronted alone at home having a miscarriage. This is a very serious, has very serious emotional fallout for it. There's post-abortion syndrome.
Why hasn't that been in the news?
How often do women look at the remains of their baby when they have a surgical abortion? That doesn't usually happen. This, what we're seeing is something different, and it's very painful.
Look, the FDA has spoken after investigating this matter for a very long time, and they have found so few instances of danger or mishap that they have done what you do, what science does. They have, in fact, said what science now says is necessary is the following. In terms of surgical abortion, we're talking about almost all abortions occurring way before even the 12th week. If that's how abortions occur anyway, then surgical abortion is already disappearing.
That are being put up.
I think there's a couple of things that we need to think about. One is that we don't know what the fallout is yet for this emotionally. We don't even know what the physical fallout, because doctors or emergency rooms are not required to report that a woman came in from an abortion. Often it says, they say it's a miscarriage. I'd like to see there to better numbers. I'd like there to be a law passed that would actually require us, so we know what's happening, what the fallout is, if women are being hurt. And so that, I think that's going to be important going forward. The other thing is,
let me say this. You talked about women seeing the remains of the zygote,
the
embryo at that stage.
The baby, I would say.
But we're talking, if a woman does, you can't even do an abortion much before 6 to 8 weeks into the pregnancy. Mm-hmm. And then I'm not sure if this applies with the birth control pill, but if you do it when when at very, very soon after you conceive, it's not going to look like anything but your period.
Well, not necessarily. That's not the story I'm being told. Obviously, I haven't lived through this. And by the way, they just changed the rules, so this is now can be used later. So I think the fallout will be greater. But the point is, this is something I think we need to think about, ladies.
But are they allowed to use 50, it beyond 12 weeks?
No. Well, you have to. It's a special circumstances, and you have to go to a doctor, and it cannot be performed at a clinic after 12 weeks. And can I also say, we don't have to speculate anymore how large of a fetus or a baby 6 weeks is or 8 weeks is. We've got the picture, so we don't have to go, well, you know, maybe it is more, maybe it isn't.
But
we
she's
know
still
what it
alone
is.
Suffering by herself, going through something very emotional, no doubt. And this is an important point, ladies. The LA Institute just came out with a number that 52% of women feel coerced into their abortion. I think that is something we need to think about and talk about. While we're talking about the emotional aspects, who's giving them the abortion?
I have a quick question, which is that according to the Guttmacher Institute again, the reason abortions dropped by from 1.36 to under a million in a decade and a half was long-term reversible forms of birth control. What's your position?
Position on birth control.
You have position on it, so you don't support it?
I am an evangelical woman. As a woman of faith, I use birth control. I only have two children. But women have to be free to have their own beliefs on this. And so for us to somehow denigrate the views of some women, Catholic women, on this, I think is disrespectful.
Well, I don't think we should denigrate it. I just think we need to make it available and have choice. You know, and women should
and
have choices.
And they do. They do all over the country.
We need more and more accessibility.
If there's coercion, it's coercion against the availability of abortion.
The whole notion
that a woman is coerced into having an abortion is the worst nonsense I have ever heard.
I will leave you if you don't do this, by parents that push them in the door. I hear these stories every day.
Yeah, well,
you're
if that's a family matter, then you better deal with those families.
but it's still coercion. It still happens.
Well, what's that got to do with public policy?
Because we are women talking about other women, whether we care about them and care about this issue. This is a serious point.
Well, I think if you're being abused and coerced, that's a totally separate problem. Mm-hmm. That's an emotional family one-on-one issue that maybe we can get that woman counseling so she gets out of an abusive relationship. But I don't think that has to do with public policy and the law of the land.
All right. Let us know what you think. Please follow me on Twitter @BonnieUrbay. And thank you for joining us for this segment, Penny.